Wait, 2021 happened already? What do you mean? It's over? Huh. Well, that was a year. Capitol Hill got raided, COVID got worse, the world got just a little bit more dystopian. Any of you hear about Elon Musk wanting to put microchips in people's heads? That's just a bit fucking weird. Just a wee bit. And wait, it's April? What do you mean he's trying to buy Twitter? Okay, whatever. Today we're going to ignore the bad things that are going on in the world and instead talk about mostly good things. Welcome one and all to my annual top 10 anime list. I do my top 10s a little bit different from most people, at least as far as I know. So first things first, I need to define what I count as an anime from last year. Simply put, any anime that I finished watching that finished airing in 2021 is eligible for this year's list. It doesn't matter if it started airing in fucking 1992. If it finished airing in 2021 and I finished it, it would be eligible. Naturally, this means that any show that has continued airing beyond 2021 will not be eligible. So no Demon Slayer Entertainment District arc or JoJo's Part 6 Stone Ocean, since it technically aired in winter anyway. These shows will be eligible for next year's list, however, by the nature of how these rules work. Similarly, just for the sake of originality, I don't allow any sequel anime to hold a spot on the list. That's not to say that I won't talk about them, but only original, season ones, or whatever, can hold a numbered spot on the list. I will discuss sequels in special in-between slots that I dub as sequel mentions. The way these work is that they'll be in between whatever numbered slots the show would normally be placed between. So if I do a sequel mention between spots 6 and 5, then that means I think the show is, quality-wise, between that of those two shows. These will only be brief discussions, however, as I do want to give more of the spotlight to the main 10 shows. Before number 1, I will do kinda a rapid-fire list of shows that didn't make the top 10, but I want to mention anyways. This isn't an honorable mentions list, however, it's simply just general mentions. So that out of the way, the only thing left I have to say is that I will be covering full spoilers for every show that I talk about in this list. There will be chapters in the video that will let you skip any part that you don't care to hear spoilers for. If you want spoiler-free thoughts on any show I talk about in this list, feel free to ask in the comments and I'll reply to you as best as I can. With that being said, however, let's begin the list. Number 10, Dungeon of Black Company. We start off this list by letting everyone know that I am a complete and utter hipster who will never conform to the measly rules of the peasantry. And by that I mean, yeah, it should be obvious that I was going to like the isekai parody anti-capitalist work comedy with the most generically unique cast of characters I've seen in an anime in a while. We've got Schrodinger's Marxist, Cocodrilo, a rejected dragon maid character, Marth from Fire Emblem's sister, and gender confusion. look, I don't even know, bro. Life's confusing enough as it is. I don't need gender envy from an anime mage who gets punched in the cock within 10 minutes of their introduction. Now, I do feel the need to address the elephant in the room, which is this show's inconsistent themes. I know I called it anti-capitalism, but really with some simple analysis, it seems really to be much more pro the status quo. It doesn't really challenge capitalism in any meaningful way. It more just makes the incredibly bold statement of not saying much of anything by the end, or at least nothing we don't already know to be the case. Overworking is bad, capitalist hellscapes are bad because of course they are. We shouldn't live our lives around what our bosses want out of us. This is pretty common sense stuff, and it's made even worse with the show also giving the messages of how good ideas under capitalism lead to better outcomes for everyone than bad ideas under capitalism, and that working 40 hours a week with benefits isn't exploitative. Yes, that's a direct line from the show. It should be obvious to anyone familiar with my channel, but I'm not exactly a big fan of capitalism, which includes the 40-hour sacrifice made as an exchange for our ability to pay off at least some of our expenses to live reasonably comfortably. The message of the show isn't exactly harmful though, but it isn't really eloquent or well-written in the first place, so I hardly mind that. This past year, I wrote notes down while watching shows, and something I wrote about this show was that this show is critiquing capitalism, but seems like it only wants to stop at what's socially acceptable to criticize. To be fair though, given that this is a story from conservative Japan with one of the most toxic work cultures in the developed world, I'm not surprised. The real good in this show, however, comes from the central cast of characters and their interactions between each other and the world around them. On the topic of the world real quick though, it's got super generic writing. It's a fantasy world that's been more or less taken over by a corporate monopoly, who eventually destroys the world and causes the rise of the Demon Lord, who is ironically less evil than the Mega Corporation. Now, I won't rationalize the characters' motivations or say that they're good people, because honestly, all of these guys are either assholes or complicit with assholes. But that can make a good comedy if they're at least funny assholes. We have good old pro-tag man and evil wannabe capitalist Nino Mia, the straight man true neutral version of Kaimon Wanibe, the hungry hungry dragon who really only exists for the marketing, Rim, the corporate bootlicker, no that's not a joke, she literally is, Shy, and the aforementioned embodiment of gender envy, confusion, and certified sack of shit, Ranga. They're just lucky they're cute. Admittedly, I'm not sure what pronouns to use for Ranga since everyone in the show calls him a boy, but they say they're more comfortable presenting as a girl. So, hey, show, be consistent for once, please. Anyways, this cast of shitheads do a wonderful job of bringing the show from a mess to a literal 9 out of 10, because their interactions and the writing surrounding them is just so ridiculously entertaining that I can't not love it. Of course, some jokes like Rim's never-ending appetite get mad old real quick. But the majority of the jokes aren't like that. In one episode, Nino Mia and Wanibe construct a plan unbeknownst to the viewers to use wild plants to prevent the company from brainwashing them. In another episode, Shy throws Nino Mia and Wanibe through a hellish training program for reasons I've forgotten didn't write down, but I know it was ridiculous. And even at the end of the series, the group successfully took down the company and made a different, slightly not as bad company that turns the mines into amusement parks. It's crazy. I do want to mention about the final episode real quick, however. There's this whole plot about Nino Mia getting arrested, and in order to free him, instead of proving his innocence or breaking him out of the jail, the group goes behind the backs of the viewers to get the opposing company, now with the power to buy out Nino Mia's company, to agree to make Nino Mia their CEO in some Ace Attorney-esque turnabout bullshit factory. It felt like a bit of a cop-out, but oh well, we can't win them all. Especially not against Ranga, what the fuck? Number 9. Komi can't communicate. Oh shit, we're doing this again? Let's just get this point out of the way. Najimi is a chaotic figure of royalty who deserves all the friends she has. They're the best character in the show, and he steals every scene that she's in. They're not even a target of gender envy at this point. He's the embodiment of gender greed. I was surprised at first after watching the show that Najimi didn't cause a huge amount of writhing from the hyper-weird subsect of people who are somehow simultaneously anime fans and Republicans. But after hearing that the first thing my friend Evan, a rather apolitical guy, said about Najimi was that he's a trap, I think I understand why Najimi didn't spark any really annoying people into action in the same way that Lily from Zombieland Saga did. Aside from that though, I'll say my one actual problem with this show is that Najimi as a character is leaps and bounds more entertaining than the rest of the cast. Most of the cast is at least fine. Komi is fine, Tadano is fine, but Aguri and Yamai are legit some of the worst side characters I've ever come across in any comedy anime ever. But at least they do basically nothing after they get their original screen time, and Yamai is at least bearable when she's not by herself and is instead accompanied by her posse. Nail files and sandpaper in hand. Basically, my point is that since Najimi is leagues ahead of the other characters, the show goes from like a 7 out of 10 to a 9 whenever she enters stage left, or right, or whatever he feels like, really. This bitch will crash through the window or blow a hole in the side of the school just to steal the show. Hell, the author of the story seems so focused on letting them take over the entire story that they forgot to take Tadano out of the maid outfit until like the end of episode 12. To be fair though, if I were cis and went to school with someone like Najimi, I'd be confused about my gender too. Although I kinda am anyway, but that's not my point. Jokes aside, Najimi is probably the second best example of a gender non-conforming character in an anime I've seen ever. There's really only one kinda tasteless joke involving her gender, and that's in episode 2, where that one guy just tries to sexually assault them in public because, hey, Najimi is pangender, did you guys know that? Here's a supposedly straight guy trying to assault him because haha, boy in skirt. At least there's nothing that bad afterward. And in fact, every joke about Najimi's gender from there on that can be construed as negative is either shut down by Najimi herself or comes straight from their own mouth. There's a joke in like episode 8 or so where Tadano tells Komi that he wouldn't be able to call a girl by her given name, and Najimi is just like, oh, so you don't think of me as a girl, huh? And just completely throws that shit out the window. Tadano is going to hypocrite jail, eat it, bitch. You might wonder why I'm focusing so much on Najimi and not the rest of the show, and that's literally because the show itself, like I said before, is like a 7 out of 10 when Najimi isn't on screen. The interactions between Tadano and Komi are fine, but hella basic. Really the only remotely interesting scenes and characters that hold a candle to Najimi's reign over the story are the episode where Komi goes to her grandma's house, the Chunibyo girl, and the track star girl who describes everything by temperature degrees. I wonder if she has a sibling who's obsessed with science and does the same thing, but with Kelvin. Most of the scenes that don't include Najimi are really fucking boring, honestly. There's one episode where Komi goes to the library, doesn't talk, and recoils into her shell, as Komi does. Tadano oversees it while trying to return library books and is just like, yeah, and leaves without returning the books. That's the joke, but it's not done. Komi then goes to a park and spins around like an idiot, and Tadano, realizing he forgot to return the books, passes the park on his bike, sees Komi doing the Irish jig or some shit, and is just like, yeah, and goes back home, again forgetting to return the books. This is some weird as shit comedy, but whatever, man. So yeah, me talking about Najimi is because he's the best character in the show, they're wanted by the FBI, he's a dirty capitalist pig, and she's the coolest guy in school. Literally the only thing determining the show existing on this list in the first place is how many appearances Najimi had in the show, because if that shit were cut in half or something, the show would be like 16th or something. Number 8, bottom tier character Tomozaki-kun. Oh boy, and now we get to the part of the list where I begin to sound like a complete degenerate. In order to defend my honor, I will preface this part by saying that before this show started airing, I completely thought this show would be absolute cringy dog shit. But after watching the PV, I completely flipped my opinion around and thought the show would be relatively charming, but probably not all that great. I really felt like this show would fulfill a really weird fantasy that a lot of guys have, of getting a cute girlfriend that will fix their life for them and make them suddenly popular. And while that's more or less exactly what happens in this show, the show is a lot more nuanced than that. Now, that doesn't mean that this show is well written, because really, it's not. But the ideas behind the show are a lot more complex, and the show itself is far more entertaining than a show with this concept has any right to be. With a strong cast of characters and rather subversive, albeit still generic, story beats, the show is a joyful ride from start to finish. The initial premise of the show is having Tomozaki getting taught by the token main girl Hinami on how to improve his life and treat it like a video game. Cringy as fuck, I know. But by the end of the show, the concept of treating life like a video game is flipped on its head as Tomozaki's philosophy begins to challenge Hinami's formulaic and pseudo-intellectualist logic-based approach to life by having Tomozaki use his emotions to make decisions. Life isn't simple or formulaic. There's no one right way to do anything in this world. And while this show doesn't have any sort of anti-authority or anti-tradition themes, the actual message of the show is very similar to these ideas. As I watched this show, I was really, really terrified of how the show was gonna end. Anime being anime, I thought Tomozaki was going to end up with Hinami, rather than the clearly better choice that is having him end up with Kikuchi. Thankfully, by the end of this show, although Tomozaki isn't with anyone yet, it's pretty clear that the story wants us to know that he won't end up with Hinami, at least. And that likely means he'll actually end up with Kikuchi. I know, that makes me sound like I don't trust anime writers. Because I don't. Romance anime have a weird track record of making the guy get with the first girl they meet in the story. And since Hinami was that girl for good old Tomozaki here, needless to say, I was worried. It should be quite the statement that all it takes for me to respect the writing of a romance anime is for them to subvert that simple expectation. Otherwise, this show was a fun romp with cute characters, and I both look forward to and potentially dread the upcoming second season. Number 7, Horimiya. Horimiya is genuinely one of the best rom-coms in recent memory. At this point on the list, the shows get genuinely great, and Horimiya is a great way to start this part of the list. The concept of the show is admittedly super generic, since it's just another rom-com set in high school, and it's not really a deep show. The themes are really just explaining that love can come from unexpected places, and to not judge a book by its cover. Pretty surface-level themes. So you might be asking, what's good about this show? Well, I'm glad you asked. This is likely going to be the shortest entry on the list, but oh well. This show thrives off the comedy and characters. The comedy isn't gut-bustingly funny by any means, but it's far from generic, bringing unique ideas to the table and making the show immensely entertaining in that way. On the other hand, the characters are all insanely likable. Whether it's our main couple, Hori and Miyamura, the dorky student council president Sengoku, and Hilda from Fire Emblem, Remy, even Fuckin Iura, who does nothing before episode like 11, but ends up being one of the coolest characters in the show. Shout out to loudmouth dork characters, gotta be one of my favorite genders. We've got a lot of those so far, crazy how that works. The actual writing of the show isn't super special, but it does subvert expectations on the regular with the pacing of the show. Not only do the main characters get together in this show, they fuck! Yeah! In episode 7, only halfway through the season! They even fucking graduate high school by the end of this season! I said season twice now because I'm praying that they make a season 2, or else my wallet is going to shed so many tears over yet another manga series getting added to my list. The story obviously isn't over yet, but hot damn did I not expect the story to go beyond high school. Most high school rom-coms are pretty self-contained, sticking primarily to the high school setting, only changing the locale when the writers get bored and want to send them to like a festival or the pool. Now these aren't bad tropes, but they do slow down the time progression of the story. Horimiya does have a festival episode if I remember correctly, but they still graduated at the end of the show. That one narrative decision made me get super enthralled in the writing of this story. Better yet, there's still so many loose ends with the vast majority of the characters, which lets us know, as viewers, that even though they graduated from high school already, the story isn't dropping the so-called extras anytime soon. Perhaps the dawn of another theme in the story, that true friendships are unbreakable? Maybe I'm in over my head and just overanalyzing the fuck out of this rom-com, but wouldn't you prefer deep and meaningful thoughts on a show, rather than one of the big Annie-tubers saying, "Yeah, it's funny!" and then ranking it like number 4 or something? Yeah, I'm on to you, Giguk. Number 6. So I'm a spider, so what? This show is basically the perfect example of a simultaneous crescendo and decrescendo. The story of this show only gets more and more intriguing and well-written as it goes, but the animation goes from extremely competent and borderline breathtaking with its amazing use of CG and the fights Kumoko gets into the worst shit imaginable. To borrow an analogy I heard once, the first quarter of this show is expertly polished dog shit. It looks great, but it's so tiring and boring. I'll admit that much. All these episodes really do is introduce the power system of the world in the most generic way possible. Kumiko beats shit up, she gets more skills, and really this persists across the entire show, but everything she does in the first quarter of the show is mad boring. Her classmates, having reincarnated as mostly humans, one of them is an earth dragon for some reason, are far more interesting. A bit tropey at first, as we have the obvious hero pro tag, the best friend character who became a girl for some reason, the obvious anti-hero slash antagonist, the pet, the teacher slash instructor, and Yuri, who's just kind of there. There's also the hero's little sister who does nothing except murder the king and frame her brother after being brainwashed, which sounds like a Shakespearean plot twist, but you'd be surprised how unimportant that action is. I'll just cut to the chase and explain what makes this show so good then. The perspective constantly shifts between Kumoko's misadventures in the Labyrinth of Hell and the other classmates going through Isekai Magic School, which wrongly makes you think that these stories are happening at the same time. They aren't. This doesn't get explicitly revealed until like 18 episodes in, but if you can't figure this shit out long before then I don't know what to tell you. What's actually going on is that Kumoko's story is happening 15-ish years prior to what the students are going through. So while her classmates are dicking around in school, unbeknownst to them that they're about to go on the most generic adventure ever, Kumoko has essentially become God. Simultaneously, she's the Demon Lord, the right-hand man of the Demon Lord, and the almost mythologically powerful monster known as the Nightmare of the Labyrinth. That may sound stupid, but you have to trust me when I say that it makes sense in the context of the story. While I'm certain that reincarnating an entire class of students into an isekai setting isn't a concept inherent to this story, it is interesting how they use this concept to completely upend the hierarchy of the classroom. The teacher isn't as powerful as she once was. Characters like Kumoko and Sophia, once outcasts from the class, are some of the most powerful members now. Some of them are fucking dead! And even a good trio of friends have their relationships completely rewritten, as one of them was reborn as the opposite gender, and another was born so far removed from the others that he ended up being in the Demon Lord's army. The way their former identities dictate their current existences is very well done, too. Sophia, a formerly outcasted creepy girl that seemingly had no friends, is now a powerful, upfront, and commanding vampire with an admittedly stupid design. The class president is now in a much more standoffish position, as she no longer has the mutual respect for the teacher that she had prior. Even Katya speaks in a much more boyish tone when around other reincarnations or people who know about them. Really, I think the strongest point about this show is just the way the story and characters are handled. Many of the characters are well-developed, with interesting and realistic motivations. The world-building is succinct, interesting, and unique, doing a great job of both complimenting the characters and being complimented by the characters. And the animation, well, is situational. I don't want to spoil too much, because honestly, not enough people have seen this show, and I want to leave a reason for people to check it out sooner or later. So do that, watch it, it's very good. Just close your eyes during the fight between Shun and Sophia. It's better if we just ignore that. Number 5, Jobless Reincarnation. Quick disclaimer, this entry is only for Season 1 because, well, I haven't seen Season 2 yet. But yeah, if you can look past the weird incestual relationship that Rudis has with his cousin, this show is pretty damn good. Yeah, that's quite a huge flaw for Rudis as a character. But the show actually does a pretty tasteful job of integrating a child with the mental capacity of a 40-year-old into the story. It actually feels like it matters that the show is an isekai, which is not something you hear really ever. Rudis's character development actually feels earned, which is, again, not something you hear really ever. Most of the time, isekai protagonists become as powerful as God just by sneezing and having black hair or Kirito syndrome. That's part of what makes so many isekai complete and utter trash. We need a reason to get behind a character, and Rudis, for his many questionable character flaws, has those reasons. He has a reason to better himself, something to fight for, and flaws that prevent him from being infallible. Another great aspect of the show is the focus on the world, rather than the focus on just Rudis or just the magic power system. The Spurts are written throughout most of the season to be this dangerous, cruel race of people, and so they're constantly discriminated against. But after Rudis meets the character Rougerd, that narrative is flipped on its head. Sure, this is just another anime doing the whole racism is bad theme, but it's done, again, rather tastefully. Admittedly, there's not a whole lot to discuss with this show, which is further just not helped by me not having seen the second season. But yeah, my main praise for this show consists of just how well done the world building is. The Spurts, the area that Rudis gets dropped into later in the season, the moral conflict between Rudis and Rougerd, Rudis' role in the world, the magic system, the other characters, the language barriers, even just the progression of the story itself. It's all so well done, and I can't praise the show enough for that. It's conceptually extremely generic, due to no fault of its own, thanks to how inundated the isekai genre is, but if nothing else, it stands strong on its own, and manages to be an extraordinarily well-written show, just with, again, questionable character relationships. I've heard it gets worse in Season 2 as well, so I'm ready to chug Pepto-Bismol if or when it gets really bad. Number 4, The Case Study of Vanitas. Whoa, hold on! A show that not everyone and their mother watched? Over Jobless Reincarnation? Yeah, that's right. I'm not like those other bitches with their 120 frames per second balls of water and pieces of bread. Also, I just prefer the remaining shows, which should be obvious. But the internet is a relentlessly bitchy entity that would definitely try and grill me till I'm well done for daring to prefer other shows over this past year's darling. Anyways, The Case Study of Vanitas, it's fucking spectacular. Sure, it's not Jobless Reincarnation, but that's why it's better. I'll just come right out and say that I'm not a big fan of the vampire subgenre of stories, so me putting this show so far up on the list should be really telling of its quality. This show hella hooked me from the get-go with its first episode. I'm not the biggest fan of stories essentially telling you how it ends from the very beginning, but this show manages to make it work. Basically, in episode 1, they reveal that Noe is going to kill Vanitas at some point, but they give zero context as to why, how, or when. And it's not this dynamic of these besto friendos not knowing that one of them will kill the other at some point, because these guys argue like a married couple, and it's great. The dynamic between not even just Noe and Vanitas, but between every character is just so believable. Balances of love and hate, intrigue and disgust, it's very compelling. Of course, this balance of characters' feelings for each other is kinda overshadowed by the feral blood-sucking that they do to each other all the fucking time. Legit, about every episode or so, a character will bite another character's neck and suck their blood while the other character enjoys it. It's fucking weird! But it never feels like fan service, due to the simple fact that no one barring middle-aged men in Transylvania and white middle school girls from 2010 find this shit attractive. There's always some narrative or character-based reason for the blood-sucking. And while it's weird to watch, it'd be equally weird if they didn't use it to develop the characters. Of course, the humans aren't sucking each other's blood, that'd be weird. But this is a show about vampires, what did you expect? As far as the world goes, it's actually really interesting so far. Not super intriguing as of yet, but the way in which different aspects of the world have been introduced over the course of the show's run feels natural and enticing. Hell, I'd say the world building of the show, while not as good as Jobless or other shows we've already gone over, it does rival the world building of some of the better shonen worlds out there in terms of its dynamics, organizations, politics, and people. Hell, it's even better than shows like Fire Force, which despite its flaws, does a good job of establishing the world the characters live in. Sure, there's no map of the world or central structure keeping it together, but it's easy to follow, easy to understand, and is written in a way that makes you want to know more about the world. Everything in the world makes sense, and it feels deserved. It's just good, man. Another thing this show does a good job of is making antagonistic characters turn over a new leaf and join the good fight in believable ways, while still keeping the reservations of their new alliance. Luca, Jean, and Roland all start off as huge obstacles for the main duo before being believably turned over to ally themselves with the protagonist through common interests and by clearing up misunderstandings. Sure, in Roland's case, it is the classic anime trope theme of realizing racism is bad, but oh well. Now, this is a thing that happens in a lot of stories, especially battle shonens, but it seems to rarely be done well. Spoilers, but take part 3 of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, for instance. The main group of characters has 6 characters, 3 of which join from the beginning under an agreed common cause, and a 4th reluctantly joins later on. But the characters of Kakyoin and Polnareff start off as antagonists. Not because of a misunderstanding or anything like that, though. It's because they were being mind-controlled, because of course they were. Vanitas doesn't do anything like that. It has antagonistic characters join the good fight because they're convinced to help out, rather than being mind-controlled initially. It's much better this way, I feel. And all that said, with Season 2 having aired, I'm excited to get back into this banger of a show. Number 3, Kai Byoui Ramune. If you haven't heard of this show before, then you better blame the big AnnieTubers who were frothing at the mouth over Jobless Reincarnation and Horimiya back last winter, despite saying, "The season is too good to talk about everything," which was just an excuse to talk about Jobless and Horimiya exclusively. Now, I won't say that they were wrong about how good winter was, because so far, 5 of the shows on this list were from the winter season. But I heard literally 0 people talk about this show this past year, despite it being an absolute banger! Now, before I spoil anything in order to talk about the show, this is your last chance to check the show out for yourself before I ruin the whole story. Okay, so basically, this show is fucking great. Easily the most underrated show of 2021, without a fucking doubt. I'm not gonna go over the concept of the show, I'm just gonna jump into it. This show is an amazing little piece of work about a man who wants to do his best to improve people's lives in a way that only he can, hence the supernatural aspects. Sure, the presentation of these ideas are ridiculous, but it perfectly exemplifies the delusions that people put on themselves when trying to figure out what's wrong with them or how to be quote-unquote normal. So yes, crying condiments, making popcorn from your head, or having your dick turn into a chikuwa are ridiculous ideas, but are perfectly ridiculous metaphors for very real problems that people can have in their daily lives. These afflictions, presented as supernatural diseases representing direct metaphors of your body screaming at you to realize what your problems are, supernaturally physical forms of wasting away from being used to riches and longing to have a real relationship, holding yourself back for the sake of someone else's success, and even suppressing your own creativity. Every supernatural illness in this show is a perfectly ridiculous representation of problems that people can have, and do a wonderful job of helping people overcome their problems, all thanks to the main character of the show, helping in a way that only he can. On that note, the supernatural illnesses serve a dual purpose, by displaying in an obvious way a problem that only the main character can help to fix. It's dual symbolism, both for people's problems and for how Dr. Ramune himself can help people. Ramune is introduced as a bit of a weirdo and even a fraud, but by the end of episode 1, he became one of the most likable and believable protagonists of any anime this past year, even including sequels. I could go over every single character and story present in this show, but on the off chance that you're still here and haven't seen this show, I really hope this made you want to watch it, and I won't spoil anything else for you. This show, while not the best in the production department, is an underrated gem that deserves more recognition. It's absolutely excellent, and I will never forgive big AnnieTubers for just never mentioning its greatness. I know you guys are trying to be topical because it's literally your job, but Christ, give something to this show, please! Sequel mention 1. ReZero Season 2 Part 2. ReZero hit the big time again with another great season, with amazing moments and conclusions to big plot lines, as well as confusing the fuck out of me with why the story progresses the way that it does. The show is still obviously incomplete, but whenever more comes, I'll be here for it. Number 2. Tokyo Revengers. Ah, yes. The Nazi middle school gang war show, just minus the Nazi symbolism. I know, it's a manji, but I don't care. Tokyo Revengers is, without a doubt, one of the strongest time travel stories I've ever seen. This show manages to describe how minor adjustments to the past can snowball into an insane future that's nearly unrecognizable compared to what you were familiar with. Multi-layered problems, situations that involve every character in the story, and a plot that can only be mended by the protagonist. This praise only scratches the tip of the iceberg as to what makes this show so good. That being said, I'll voice some of my criticisms first to get them out of the way. This one isn't inherently unique to this show, but anime in general tends to have recaps of the prior episode at the beginning of a new one, and sometimes they take 15 seconds, other times they take 2 to 3 minutes, and Tokyo Revengers tends to fall into the latter category. Like I've mentioned earlier, I wrote notes on every show I watched to make writing this script easier, and there were times I was able to write down all of my thoughts on one episode during the next one's recap. It was absurd. Another really weird inconsistency in this show was how sometimes characters died from one strike of a weapon, while other times they were barely hurt. Prime example was how Kazutora immediately killed Mikey's older brother with one swing of a pair of bolt cutters, but years later, he's smashing Mikey's head in with a lead pipe, and Mikey's still kicking after several swings. It's minor, but God, it's weird. Last criticism before I get into the good shit. I don't like that everyone's a middle schooler. Middle schoolers don't act like this. I don't care. You can't convince me that Godzi was both able to survive after suffering a fatal stab wound for way too long in the trash heap fight, and is also 15. Fuck off. If they were all high schoolers, I could buy it at least a little more. But them being middle schoolers is fucking ridiculous. But now for the good shit. Holy shit. So many good characters, with the exception of Emma, some of the leaders of Tomon, and all of Takemichi's friend circle, minus Akun. Every character, no matter how minor, gets a ton of screen time, unique character traits, and good moments. Draken, Mikey, Kazutora, Godzi, Chifuyu, Peiyan, Pachin, Kiyomasa, Akun, and of course, Takemichi. The show is full to the brim with well-written characters of varying moralities, with other characters like Hanma and Mitsuya being cool additional characters even if they don't have much in the way of development. I notably excluded Hina and Kisaki, because so far they're just a standard love interest and antagonist, respectively. They a bit basic. Really though, the standout greatness of this show comes from the characters and their interactions and how they drive the plot. The entire conflict of this show, so far, is driven on these conflicts. Draken stopping Pachin from killing the leader of Valhalla leads to a world where Draken gets killed by either Peyon or Kiyomasa with no interference from Takemichi. Baji leaving Toman to spy on Valhalla and see how Kisaki is involved with everything leads to his own death, Kazutora's imprisonment, and Kisaki getting further ahead in Toman's ranks. Presumably, something Takemichi did caused Kisaki to get involved in Toman in the first place. The conflict of the show is layered among the characters, and so far, it's doing a great job of getting me to care about the conflict, the characters, and what happens next. This isn't something I wrote in the script, but it's something I want to say anyways. But something that occasionally irks me about time travel stories is that they have characters going back in time thinking that because they know everything, they can fix everything. Tokyo Revengers doesn't do that. Whenever Takemichi goes back to the past, even with an exact goal in mind, he doesn't always achieve it entirely. The second half of the show focuses on an arc where he's trying to save Baji from getting killed at the trash heap fight. He fails, but he still succeeds in other ways. He may know everything, but he doesn't stop everything from happening. Whenever season 2 does come out, you can bet I'll be there to check it out. By the way, passing thought, but with the manji / swastika symbolism from the manga, does that mean Kisaki is supposed to be a parallel to Hitler? I mean, we don't really know enough about him to know for sure yet, but it's just something to consider, I guess. Sequel mention 2, Dr. Stone, Stone Wars. Honestly, I can understand why people don't really like Dr. Stone all that much, but I genuinely really like this series. It's not perfect, it's kinda shallow, but this show is continuing to be an amazing testament as to what you can do with a good idea. This season in particular set up for so many new plot lines to follow in season 3, and without revealing too much, they did a believable job of doing a complete antagonist swap. That's not something you always hear from a shonen anime, that's for sure. Sequel mention 3, Beastars Season 2. Beastars came back fucking swinging, holy shit. If it weren't for this year having some really heavy hitters, Beastars Season 2 would probably have been my technical number 1. The show looks better than ever, and it finally filled in the plot hole that was my biggest complaint with Season 1, being that they just never focused on the death of Tem. And with the main relationship between Legoshi and Haru already being set up and past the uncomfortable furry stuff, this season was just a detective battle shonen all the way through with the same gritty morality that season 1 had. The villain of this season is probably my single favorite antagonist from this year. What a season. Sequel mention 4, Higurashi Go / Sotsu. Okay, quick disclaimer, this placement is mostly a what could have been for Sotsu, and is more meant to be praising Go. Anyone who's been on my channel for longer than the past year and a half knows that I can talk forever about When They Cry, so I'll keep myself condensed here, and potentially make a separate video in the future discussing my retrospective thoughts on Go and Sotsu. Basically, Sotsu was a bit of a disappointment, but in a meat-headed way, it was super entertaining, despite flubbing up the story a lot more than I thought it would. As for Go? God damn. There were some slight disappointments in Go, because of course nothing is perfect, but all the potential plot threads and way for the conflict to evolve that Go set up were great. So in a vacuum, Go is fantastic, in my opinion. Also, to take a side real quick, I'm firmly in the camp that says you shouldn't start your Higurashi experience with Go, but I'll give some ground and say that you technically could start with Go and not completely ruin the original series for yourself. Even if you spoil the main conflict of the original through Go, it can still be enjoyable. Jujutsu Kaisen just barely didn't make the list. It's a fun, well-choreographed shonen fight series, and is pretty damn hardcore compared to most other shows in that genre. The fights in the second arc were pretty good on average, especially the one with Itadori and Todo fighting Hanami. But the first arc definitely carried the show. Looking forward to the eventual season 2. Uma Musume was surprisingly good, and Season 2 definitely kept up that pace, but I do want to complain about how Season 2 relied way too much on pushing the narrative forward through injuring characters. Teo broke her leg 3 fucking times, and McQueen almost snapped a tendon or something in the last act of the show. Felt like they wanted to injure a character again, but thought Teo suffered enough. It's stupid, but it was entertaining nonetheless. Life Lessons with Uramichi Oni-san was funny as hell. The animation was average at best and was noticeably choppy, but the characters were strong, the comedy didn't get old, and the overall art quality was really good. Easily the best comedy of 2021. Remake Our Life was entertaining, but it really did rub me the wrong way with how it suddenly just revealed that Keiko was a god or something. And it feels like by the end, it's sending a pretty negative message. There was an arc in the latter third of the show where Kyoya was thrown a decade into the future, where his actions and existence in the past had negatively impacted the creative careers of his classmates. But then he just goes back in time again and is like, I can fix that, Lamau. I know the story isn't over, but this season really makes it sound like redoing your life is a good thing or something. It shouldn't be romanticized. I only want to bring up Heaven's Design Club for three reasons. One, the comedy was good on average, but occasionally got stale. Two, the concept is really fucking good, and I'm surprised that this hasn't been done before. And three, the character Venus is a trans woman, which isn't ever explicitly mentioned or dug into. She just exists in the show. And for a show that literally takes place in heaven, you know, the Christianity place, I think that's mad respectable. 86 was a huge disappointment. I didn't watch it until I saw it get nominated for Anime of the Year by Crunchyroll, and I have to say, this show is so painfully average. The writing isn't great, the themes are surface level as fuck, simply amounting to, again, racism is bad, and also, what does it mean to be human? Which have been tackled all the time by stories in several mediums. The story is, really bad, actually. The world building is competent at worst and mildly interesting at best, but the characters are treated like sandbags. The 86s, there's like 20 of them at first, one dies during their introduction, another dies for fucking shock value in like episode 4, two more die basically immediately after the handler promises to keep them all alive in a fit of dramatic irony, four more die in an explosion, and then I shit you not, seven of them die off screen, only one of them getting any information of how they died like two episodes after they were confirmed to be dead. You want to know who survives? By the way, look at the key art. There's your survivors. Or, well, I think they were all teased to be dead by the end of episode 11. I haven't touched season 2 yet, for context's sake. They even killed off the robot dog thing in episode 10. Probably because they realized he still existed and they forgot he wasn't in the key art. 86, more like 80, 6 out of 10. The Detective is Already Dead was fun, albeit really average. The individual mysteries treat you like an idiot because they are damn near impossible to figure out without guessing. Meanwhile, the overall mystery of the show is literally the easiest thing to figure out in the world. It's so fucking cheesy and poorly written, but it's a fun romp. Urasekai Picnic was mind-meltingly mind-melting and has the most insanely convoluted story to accompany the tired theme of friendship being magical or whatever. It's a weird watch with not much substance that I think could have been made way more interesting. But oh well. The World Ends With You, the animation, was, well, exactly what the name suggests. A rather bogged-down adaptation of The World Ends With You, featuring really good art that captures the visual style of the game pretty well, accompanied with animation that should really be expected of art this good. On the bright side, the animation isn't so bad to the point where my monkey brain can recognize the seams. My biggest gripe with this show is that they cut Mina Mimoto's line where he just rattles off like 300 digits of pi. But I can overlook that thanks to the banger line that is, THIS MIC IS ZETA SEXY! Peach Boy Riverside made the absurd decision of airing its episodes out of order, which is admittedly fucking ridiculous, but I'd be lying if I said that it didn't feel like there was a method to the madness. The first two episodes follow each other chronologically, and then we skip ahead to near the end of the show. Then we're brought to the technical episode 1, which gives the backstory to Mikoto. Hell, even the technical episode 12 didn't feel as climactic as the episode 12 we got. I could just be extrapolating from air, but I really did feel like they knew what they were doing here. Wonder Egg Priority was easily the biggest disappointment of the year. It had an amazing start and then just fumbled into dog shit by the final third of the show. Such a lesson in missed potential. That's not to say that there aren't any good points of the final act. The girls do eventually save the people that they were trying to bring back to life, which resulted in the saved girls forgetting who they were, which is interesting. But the alternate timeline, time-skipping bullshit, science experiments gone wrong, and an evil ginger child just felt so disappointing. We could have had something really cool here, But instead, we just got nothing but a disappointment. And Girlfriend, Girlfriend, the finale of our mentions, was fucking horrible. Bad message, bad characters, bad writings. It's stupid as fuck, but it's an incredible dumpster fire to sit through and make fun of. What's more, the moment-to-moment writing and conversations between the characters is so goddamn cyclical. They just say the same things over and over again for like 10 minutes at a time. It sucks, but it's so goddamn funny. It's so bad it's good. Only real takeaway though is that Saki is bi, and I think that's pretty neat. Breaking new ground for the harem genre. Number 1, Odd Taxi. Oh, whoa, hold on, is Godzi not being contrarian? You're goddamn right I'm not. Everyone and their mother was saying that Odd Taxi is one of, if not, the best anime of 2021, and I wholeheartedly agree. Okay, goodbye to anyone who clicked off the video after seeing my number one, whether you agree or disagree. To anyone who's still here, let's talk. First off, I want to say that I fucking called the twist. You're free to not believe me, since I have zero proof that I called it, other than my notes doc, where I wrote my theory after episode 8 or something. In fact, here's word for word what I wrote in my notes doc. Otokawa's medical problem is that he sees everyone as animals. Think about it. There's only two reasons why there's animals in the show. One is to differentiate the characters on a visual level so that no one gets confused on who is who. And the second is, obviously, to show the power structures of the society, right? Nope! There's no power structures. There's no predator or prey relationship with anyone. Otokawa can easily spot people in a crowd because he can see people as animals. The picture of Kakihana, both the viewer and Otokawa easily recognize. But Taiko and Goriki struggled with it. He was able to recognize Taichi because he's a hippo in his eyes. He's the only character I can think of who has referred to other characters as animals. He called Goriki a gorilla, Shirakawa an alpaca, Shiho a calico cat, and Taichi a hippo. No one else has done that. Better piece of evidence, Tanaka. Tanaka put on a skull mask and had a gun, and went to the cabaret club to supposedly threaten Otokawa. Everyone except for Otokawa and Domu knew that the guy wasn't Domu, but everyone else thought it was Domu, despite the obviously different build, the cat ears, and the tail. Domu obviously looks completely different even though he was disguised, so naturally, Otokawa is the only one seeing people as different animals. End citation. Sure, I didn't guess that the missing girl was Mitsuya until that was revealed, or that she was killed by Sakura, the girl who replaced her in the idol group, but hey, oh well. My only real complaint about the show is this one visual metaphor from the final episode, at the point where Otokawa drove off the bridge and into the water. A bunch of characters saw that happen, and visualized something dropping into the water that related to their character. For example, Rui visualized Mitsuya's body bag getting thrown into the water, Shiho visualized a bar of soap dropping into a tub because she likes baths, and Sakura visualized a piece of chicken dropping into a deep fryer because she likes chicken. It's a dumb metaphor. Super big nitpick, I realize. I also want to give a ton of credit to the cat in Otokawa's apartment. The entire show, it was set up in a way so that the cat in his apartment could be an actual person he kidnapped. But at the end, they reveal that it was just a regular cat, to which Otokawa was relieved. A mystery set up during the entire season that only served to set up a little gag at the end. I appreciate that. The characters in the show are particularly great too. Sure, some are kind of big backseat characters or super one-note, like Taichi, Shiho, Sekiguchi, and Yano. But between Otokawa, Kakihana, Rui, Imai, Domu, Yamamoto, and Shirakawa, the show's cast is stacked. Really, I've already gone over everything that makes this show great, so check it out if you haven't. Although I've already spoiled everything for you by now, so sorry? I did warn y'all, don't blame me. And so we've reached the end of this video. God damn, I can't believe I'm probably not gonna have this video out until May, fuck's sake. 2021 was strong, too strong. I wouldn't even be surprised if I missed any shows that would have been insane contenders. But nonetheless, it's time to look to the future. Hopefully I'll have my 2022 top 10 out in January next year, you know, like I'm supposed to. Either way, that's gonna be it for this video. If you liked it, then be sure to press the like button, and if you didn't like it, then fuck you too. Remember to subscribe, follow me on Twitter, and hit that notification bell to stay up to date on all my videos and stuff. And as always, my name is Godzi, and I will see you all next time. goodbye.